So before I tell you how North Korea then really pursued the bomb, is I'm going to tell you a little bit about what's required to build a bomb. And there are essentially three different aspects to building the bomb. And the first one is making the bomb fuel. You know, that's the fissionable material, the stuff that you can split. And there are basically two bomb materials. One is plutonium, and the other one is highly enriched uranium. That's generally considered to be the most difficult part of making the bomb. The second part that we call weaponization is essentially designing the bomb, building the bomb, making the weapon itself. You got to start with physics and computation because you have to understand the nuclear physics of fission and of chain reactions. High explosives, because that's in essence how you start the nuclear reaction with high explosives. And then a whole bunch of other things, including a lot of engineering that goes into making the bomb. And then the third, if you're going to have the bomb, you have to deliver it somehow to get it to the target. Well, B-29 was the method of delivery for Nagasaki and Hiroshima, but obviously the method of choice today would be a missile. And that missile, whether it's either ground-launched or a submarine-launched missile. So the bottom line of all of this is, you know, this is difficult. It's not an easy job, but it's not impossible for a determined nation. And that's the story of North Korea. Now, just to give you a little bit more of the science that you need to understand about nuclear fission, about bombs, where does this stuff come from? Well, you look at the periodic table, and the only practical fissionable materials are uranium and two different forms of uranium that we call isotopes, uranium-235 and uranium-233, and then plutonium. And the isotope of choice for plutonium is 239. These occur way down here, essentially at the bottom of the periodic table. The reason that they're the practical fissionable materials is when you get to that bottom of the periodic table, there are so many subatomic particles, particularly so many protons and neutrons, that the nucleus becomes very unstable. And therefore, it's easy to split. And it only takes another neutron of almost energy for these materials, and you split. And when you split, you get that factor of millions. So that's, in essence, what you need. It turns out the other elements, as you go up from americium, curium, and berkelium, and so forth, they also split easily, but they don't stick around long enough because all of these elements are radioactive, which means while they're just sitting there, they transmute, they change. And by the time you get to the high part of that last row, they change so fast. I mean, some of them are seconds, you know, so you can build a bomb, but it's only going to stick around for a second. So that obviously doesn't work. Uranium and plutonium stick around long enough, you know, particularly plutonium-239, for example, 24,000 years. So 233 is what one essentially never hears about, but it turns out it's also one of the isotopes of uranium. That's a pretty good bomb fuel. And what's important then to know is the only one that's practical that appears in nature today is uranium. And what appears in nature is mostly the isotope uranium-238, which turns out it has three more neutrons than the fissile isotope 235. And the ore, the uranium ore that you dig out of the ground today, is 99.3 of this isotope, which is not bomb material. But the leftover 7/10 is this uranium-235. And so now the question is, so how do you make this bomb material? Well, the way that you do that, if you're going to make highly enriched uranium, you start with natural uranium. So now you have Mother Nature has given you this stuff. But it only contains 0.7% of the isotope that you want. So in essence, what you have to do, you got to throw away the rest. And that's what's called enrichment. And today, the method of choice are centrifuges. And here's a sketch of the centrifuge. A centrifuge essentially is a very fast spinning cylinder, really fast, hundreds of thousands of RPM. And what you do is you take the uranium, you turn it into a gas by mixing it with some fluorine. You get uranium hexafluoride. You feed that in, spin it real fast, and the heavier, the 238 stuff, goes to the outside. The lighter stuff goes to the inside, and you keep scooping off the lighter stuff, and you just do this over and over in what we call these cascades of centrifuges. And so that's how you get from natural uranium. And if you just slightly enrich it, that's called LEU, or low-enriched uranium, 3 to 5%, that you can feed into reactors to make electricity. But if you keep going up to 90%, then that's good bomb material. But you use the same equipment, the same methodology, to get either the 3 to 5 or to go to 90%. So the irony of this is, as we worry about countries using this technology and this capability, either for electricity or for bombs, that it takes only a few thousand of these centrifuges to make bomb fuel. And it takes tens of thousands to make enough for reactors, because reactors have a lot of fuel. The bombs don't have much. Now, if you want to make plutonium, it turns out plutonium, you also start with natural uranium. You have to get the fission process going by some mechanism. And then once you get the fission process going, then it's now the 238, the predominant uranium isotope in Mother Nature. If you can have it pick up a neutron, which it easily does, then it, through a number of nuclear decays, actually goes to plutonium-239. So that's how you make, you have to make plutonium in a reactor. You don't just pick it up from Mother Nature. And this is a photo of the North Korean nuclear reactor, the so-called 5 megawatts electric. In other words, you could make 5 megawatts worth of electricity in that reactor. Okay, so now you've made the plutonium, essentially atom by atom, but now you have to extract it from whatever that chemical mess is that's left from the fission process. And that's called or done in a reprocessing facility. So now, since plutonium has different chemistry than uranium, you can separate the two with various acids, and you can build a reprocessing facility, extract the plutonium, and now you would have the plutonium bomb fuel. But you have to make a reactor, and you have to build a reprocessing facility. Commercial light water reactors, which use the low-enriched uranium, they also make plutonium, but typically that is not as good a bomb fuel as what you can make in reactors that can actually use natural uranium. And to use natural uranium, you have to build a very special kind of reactor, and you have to slow the neutrons down for good physics reasons, and you slow them down either with a graphite or with heavy water. And so that's a plutonium production reactor. Okay, so now let me address the question. So how can an apparently backward country like North Korea actually develop such sophisticated technologies? Well, first of all, let me tell you, they not only have to do that, I said they have to do weaponization. And so weaponization means building the bomb. And there are essentially two paths to the bomb. One is, that works particularly for highly enriched uranium, you take two halves of highly enriched uranium, you put them in a gun barrel, in essence, and you slap them together as fast as you can. When you do that, you not only get fission, you get a chain reaction, and you get the chain reaction quickly enough that it blows up and gives you this incredible power. So for this, as I mentioned, how it's produced, it only takes a few tens of kilograms of this highly enriched uranium to build this bomb. And we call this a gun assembly, because it's in essence a gun that's propelled with propellant. For plutonium-239, for very good physics reasons, that doesn't work. It's too slow. So you have to assemble the critical mass much more quickly. And what you do is you start with a piece of plutonium, essentially grapefruit size, only 6 kilograms or so. And then you implode it very quickly with high explosives, with a very sophisticated lens system. You implode that, and that's how you get the fission in the plutonium. And as I mentioned, it takes less than 10 kilograms. This gun assembly was Hiroshima, and the implosion was Nagasaki. So just to show you this, and I have a cartoon, if you watch the left-hand side, there's great difference, even though you use the same fission process, great difference between bombs and reactors. And the bombs, as I mentioned, use chemical explosive to actually go ahead and compress the bomb fuel to supercritical, and eventually it blows up. And that can be done either with plutonium or highly enriched uranium. And the geometry has to be perfect, spherical, because you want to make sure the neutrons don't escape. You keep them all together until the right moment when it blows up. Okay, so to go from a bomb to the reactor, you have a very different geometry. Instead of having the sphere in here, what you have is you have fuel rods, and these are things as skinny as my finger, many, many feet long, and in the case of the North Korean reactor, you have 8,000 of these stacked together, and there you want to control the critical reaction instead of have it go fast. And so this reactor can produce heat. Heat produces electricity. That's the peaceful part. It cannot blow up in a mushroom cloud.